Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Vibha Sinha, Assistant Professor in DAV College Chandigarh. The paper deals with policy making process. This process involves negotiation, bargaining, and accommodation. No doubt, the role of institutions are important both directly and indirectly, but state has again an important role to play. However, it functions within the constitutional parameters like directive principles of state policy, fundamental rights, the union and the state concurrent list, etc. Apart from it, the other important bodies include the political parties, the NGOs, the public in general, etc. They are all involved in policy making, and without considering these, the policies framed cannot be implemented to the maximum benefit of the people. The objectives include: number one, role played by the executives at the center in policy making in India; number two, to know about the formal structures which play a vital role in policy making, what the alternative agencies of policy making are; to describe major challenges which India face in policy making. Public policy making occupies a very important position in the functions of the state. The formulation of public policy is a complex and dynamic process. Authors such as Jenkins, Rose, and Anderson have argued that policy is best seen as a process as it involves multiple actors and levels, because policy decisions are not something confined to one level of organization at the top or at one stage at the outset, but rather something fluid and ever-changing. Rose makes a similar argument when he says policy making is best conveyed by describing it as a process rather than as a single once-for-all act. This process involves negotiation, bargaining, and accommodation of many different interests, which eventually give it a political flavor. These political interactions happen within the network through which decisions flow, programs are formulated and implemented, and inter-organizational dependencies and interactions take place. Public policy has also been seen as the authoritative allocation of values by the political system, a slight variation from the previous or existing policy, equilibrium reached out of the competing group's struggle, a rational choice, or the preference of the governing elite. It can also be a combination of these processes. In the process of making policy, there are various institutions which play a role directly or indirectly. Policy making in India functions within the constitutional parameters, that is, the preamble, fundamental rights, directive principles of state policy, federal policy, union and state concurrent list. Some of the bodies which are involved in this process in India are executive, legislature, cabinet, civil servants, judiciary, boards and commissions, mass media, public opinion, research institutions, temporary commissions, statutory commissions, parliamentary committees, and NGOs. The following section would give a brief overview of the above mentioned bodies and processes and delineate their role in policy making. The Union Executive being the first one. It includes: number one, President. India adopted a parliamentary form of government wherein the executive occupies an important position. The President of India is the constitutional head of the state and the executive. The executive enforces the laws, runs the administration, makes appointment, and formulates policies. At the union level, it is the Prime Minister and his Council of Ministers, and at the state level, the Chief Minister and his Council of Ministers, who exercise the power vested in the nominal head, that is the President of India. The provisions for President are enumerated under Article 52 of the Constitution, and Article 53 states that power of the union would be vested with the President of India. All laws which have been passed by the Parliament need the consent of President before it is to become an act. Next comes the Cabinet. The Cabinet of India comprises of the Prime Minister and other Cabinet Ministers. The decisions taken by the Cabinet and Cabinet committees are fundamental to the governance of the country and form the basis of policy formulation, as also for evaluating the impact of programs, policies, plans, projects and schemes of the government. It is the cabinet which decides which policies are to be placed before the legislature for the sanction. In the Constitution of India, Article 74 only talks about the Council of Ministers and does not mention cabinet. The cabinet forms a small but powerful part of Council of Ministers. Policy making is one of the prime functions of the cabinet and defines the contours of national policy. It has various subcommittees like the Political Affairs Committee, Economic Affairs Committee, which along with the Prime Minister occupy a very important position when it comes to the realm of policy making. Next is the civil service. The Indian civil service constitute the bureaucratic wing of the government of India. The bureaucracy plays a very important role in policy making. They head the political wing of the government to identify the issues, analyze problems, and suggest alternatives after having gauged what the various population groups need. Although they are subordinated to the ministers, they hold a very pivotal position when it comes to policy formulation. Next is the Cabinet Secretary. It is primarily the coordinating agency under the Prime Minister's direction. It submits the cases to the Cabinet and its committee records, decisions, follow-up action, and reports on implementation. Cabinet Secretary, as the topmost civil servant, acts as a secretary to the Council of Ministers. He keeps watch on the progress of important administrative measures of the Government of India, which affects more than one department. He is also responsible for submitting to Cabinet and Cabinet committees such matters as require their decision or direction, thus functioning as Secretary to the Council of Ministers. The Cabinet Secretariat is responsible for the administration of the Government of India, Rules 1961, that is Transaction of Business Rules, and the Government of India Allocation of Business Rules 1961, facilitating smooth transaction of business and ministries, departments of the government by ensuring adherence to these rules. The Secretariat assists in decision making by ensuring inter-ministerial coordination, ironing out differences among ministers, departments, and evolving consensus through the instrumentality of the standing ad hoc committees of the secretary. Through this mechanism, new policy initiatives are also promoted. Next is the legislature. The Prime Minister and Council of Ministers. Under the parliamentary system of government that the Constitution of India provides, it is the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers who form the real executive, with the President of India being the nominal or constitutional head. The Prime Minister, along with the President, is to aid and assist the President in the exercise of his powers. Article 74, 75 and 78 of the Constitution provide for provisions relating to the Council of Ministers and the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister shall be appointed by the President, and other ministers shall be appointed by the President upon the advice of the Prime Minister. The Council of Ministers shall be collectively responsible to the Lok Sabha. The powers of the Prime Minister are enormous and his position is of paramount importance. All the ministers are collectively responsible to the House of the People. This responsibility, called the collective responsibility, implies that the ministers work as one unit, one team. They swim and sing together. Under the Constitution, the Parliament consists of the President in two houses, that is the Council of State, known as Rajya Sabha, and the House of the People, known as Lok Sabha. Together, these form the main organs which partake in policy initiatives, discussions, and policy formulations. Despite being the paramount body when it comes to legislation and policy making, there has been a steady decline in power of this body. The Parliament is now regarded as a body to simply legislate rather than an independent policy making body. Number two is the state executive. The governor forms the head of the state executive and also represents the center. The legislative assembly is the lower house or sole house in different states in India. The upper house is called the legislative council. When it comes to policy making, like the union government, state governments also partake in policy making process on items mentioned in the concurrent and state list. However, since the financial resources are concentrated more with the center, states are dependent on the center for funds for their activities. Local level institutions of governance. The local bodies in India are broadly classified into two categories. The local bodies for local planning, development and administration in the rural areas are referred as rural local bodies, known as panchayats. And the ones in urban areas are called urban local bodies, that is municipalities. Provisions for panchayats and municipalities have been made in Part 9 and Part 9A of the Constitution respectively. Local governance is of great significance as it is the local bodies that interact with people on a daily basis. John Stuart Mill provides two important arguments in favor of local democracy. First, that local political institutions make citizens capable of genuine and informed participation. And second, that such institutions would be more efficient if informed by local interests and local knowledge. Thus, local institutions of governance cannot be ignored when it comes to policy process, as centralized decision making can only provide with inappropriately uniform solutions to diverse local problems in a large and heterogeneous society like India. Planning Commission, it is a state agency and therefore more advisory in nature. It prepares the five-year plans and is often called the Supra Cabinet, since the Prime Minister is its chairperson and important central ministers also being a part of it. The Planning Commission was constituted in March 1950 by resolution of the Government of India and works under the overall guidance of the National Development Council. The planning commission consults the central ministries and the state governments while formulating 5-year plans and annual plans, and also oversees their implementation. The commission also functions as an advisory body at the apex level. The following functions have been assigned to the planning commission as per allocation of business rules. Number 1, assessment of the material, capital and human resources of the country, including technical personnel, and formulation of proposals for augmenting much of these resources as are found to be deficient. Number 2, formulation of plan for the most effective and balanced utilization of the country's resources. Number 3, definition of stages in which the plan should be carried out on a determination of priorities and allocation of resources for completion of each stage. Number 4, determination of the nature of the machinery necessary for implementation of the plan in all its aspects. Number 5, appraisal from time to time of the progress achieved in the execution of each stage of the plan. Next, public cooperation in national development. It also includes hill areas development, perspective planning, directorate of manpower. All these form the topmost body when it comes to policy making in India, advising the central and the state governments on the strategic planning, utilization of resources, prioritizing main goals to be achieved by the Indian state. National Development Council. It consists of the Prime Minister, few central ministers, chief ministers, and members of the Planning Commission. It is an advisory body where the 5-year plans are approved when it is being presented before the Parliament. It provides a forum for the ministers to discuss the plans at important stages in the formulation stage, thus allowing maximum inputs to be fed in, giving it an all-India outlook before it is finally presented in front of the Parliament. Thus, the National Development Council promotes collective thinking and joint action on matters of national importance. It provides a forum in which the union ministers and cabinet ministers of the state discuss the plans as important stages in their formulation. Plans are also approved at its meeting after their completion and before they are presented to the parliament and the state legislature. In this way, the national character of the plan is emphasized. The council also considers social and economic policies affecting the country from a social point of view so that, where necessary, uniformity may be secured. In these ways, it gives a lead to the country on broad issues of policy and promotes collective thinking and joint action on matters of national importance. It symbolizes the federal approach to planning. The third broad category is the judiciary. It is considered as the third organ of the state and occupies an important role in policy making. The various decisions taken by it on the policies which have been formulated in accordance with the constitution, giving directions to both the central and the states in the proper formulations of policy making. Since the judiciary is independent from the executive and legislative branches of the government, the role that it can play in policy making is of great significance. Over the years, the judiciary in India, by way of judicial activism and use of public interest litigations, has been able to safeguard the freedom of citizens. Such practices by the judiciary are upholding the rights of the most downtrodden. Commissions or expert committees. This is an ad hoc committee. The Indian states also has provisions for ad hoc expert committees to seek opinion on policy reforms as an initiatives. These bodies consist of experts who closely scrutinize the policy in questions and provide their expert opinion before it is formally formulated and implemented. Such action not only improves the quality of the policy so formed, but also saves time and expenditure for the government. Mass media provides a bridge between the government and the citizens. It helps in putting forward the opinions of the people before the government, leads to public awareness on the decisions and policies being formulated by the government. The media provides the government an easy way to access the demands of the various population groups. Such feedback can be used by the government when it comes to policy formulation and also helps the government to frame policies which are suited to contemporary problems and issues being faced by the general public. The other parties are political parties, pressure groups and public opinion. Political parties provide an opportunity to the general public to partake in public activities which influence policy making. Political parties also help in generating public opinion on various issues, putting pressure on the government to concede to the demands of the people. Also, the party leadership are very often part of the various organs of the government. Thus, they directly engage in the policy formulation as well. Another mechanism by which policy decisions are influenced are by way of various groups, which at present are Association of Trade Union Workers, students, civil rights groups, environmental groups, and other non-governmental organizations. But the act of lobbying tried to indirectly influence policy making. Public opinion on the workings of the government also proved to be a valuable input to the process of policy making and also aids in the effective implementation of policy and determine the failure or success of a policy. Next is the research institutions. In the 4th 5-year plan, it was decided to give space and promote research institutions in the country. It was under this that the Indian Council of Social Science Research was created. The main objective of the institution was to encourage multidisciplinary and policy-oriented research. The notice that the government took of the findings of these research conducted here depended to a great deal on the role and influence of the leadership. The leadership working as members of important government committees acted as policy brokers, promoting the research findings of their institute and then mobilizing funds for more research. Parliamentary committee. In recent years, the role of parliament in providing inputs to policy through discussions on the financial proposals of the government has considerably eroded. In view of this trend, the parliament decided to set up standing committees for most ministries in 1993. These committees consist of members from both houses of parliament and chairs are chosen by proportional party representation. Usually, highly regarded parliamentarians are chosen to lead the committees even if they belong to the opposition. Every committee has a maximum of 45 members and each member of parliament serves a 2-year term on at least one committee. Traditionally, the NGOs have worked with local groups providing services, supplementing efforts of the government in delivering services or enabling communities to organize themselves to procure services or access entitlements. Grassroots NGOs may enter policy advocacy directly by organizing campaigns and protests themselves or joining networks or issue-based coalitions. However, there are problems of policy formulation, and one of the main problems which face policymaking in India at present is the high modernistic approach which has been used to make policy in India. As Kuldeep Mathur says, the ruling SEBI holds that specialists are inferior to generalists and that the dominant quality required of the civil servants is that of coordination have led to institutions and practices that restrict alternative policy advice from entering the final decision-making process. Some advice does reach the top, but usually only that which has been filtered through a process where political and administrative feasibility is the major concern. Policy making has to be a two-way road where the policy makers should engage with the citizens they are working for, and this can be made possible only if proper information is made accessible to the population groups. It can be concluded that policy making is being made for the people. Hence, their engagement should be sought. Their representatives include non-governmental organizations at the grassroots levels, research associations, and other activists also. However, the most important thing is that the government should see that the information related to these policies should reach the various population groups in the society. Then only it can be successful. I hope the module on policy making will satisfy the students regarding their knowledge. Thank you.